Hi folks, welcome back. I hope you're all doing well. So today I'm looking at a paper that came out just about a week ago, as of the date of this recording. And this paper is looking at how to get better results with LLMs that generate code based on prompts. So we're all familiar with things like Copilot, how they can generate code given a prompt or given a skeleton. But what happens if that code is not quite right? If that code has bugs or it's not passing all its test cases and you need to debug it and change it based on the feedback from those failures. And the key insight of the paper here is to basically mimic the debugging process that human programmers go through. The typical debugging process of a human programmer will usually have some notion of tracing the values of variables through an execution trace. And people might do this by printing the values of variables, good old print debugging, or they might do it by setting breakpoints and stepping through code in a debugger. But it is that visibility into the granular values of variables at various points in the execution that helps programmers debug their code. And that is exactly the process that the authors are trying to mimic here, but by using prompts with an LLM. This diagram shows an overall sketch of the process. So you start with step zero, where you give the LLM an English language task description and ask it to generate some code to accomplish that. And that gives you some initial code. And then maybe you have some test cases that you want to run through to check if that code satisfies all your requirements. And if it doesn't, then what you will typically do is look at the control flow of your code. And this is step one in this process, where you do some static analysis. This doesn't need to be dynamic yet. You simply look at the control flow graph, and you can do this purely by looking at the source code without needing to execute it. Now that you have the control flow graph, you can break out your program into basic blocks. A basic block is simply a chunk of code that within it executes in a straight line. So execution only ever enters a basic block from the beginning and only ever leaves a basic block from the end. So essentially, these are all the places in your code that are either sources of branches or targets of branches. So now you've broken your generated program into a control flow graph, which consists of basic blocks with arrows depicting control flow between those basic blocks. And you have the execution trace of a failing test case. What does this execution trace consist of? It basically consists of the values of the variables in your code at basic block boundaries. And this is where step three comes in, the key debugging step, where you query the LLM with a prompt plus this execution trace to ask it if this execution trace had a bug in it, and if it did, why? And this is the place where the LLM will try to find bugs by using its reasoning abilities to see if the various values of variables are consistent with the task description that the code is trying to accomplish. And once the LLM finds the problem with some logic in a basic block that is not quite right, you will then ask it to regenerate the program to fix that bug. And this loop continues from there. If all your tests pass, then you're done. If not, then you go around the loop one more time. I do want to look at the concrete prompts that they used, but before we jump into that, let's quickly look at the results they got. So they tried it with three large LLMs, GPT-3.5, Code Llama, which is a 34 billion parameter model, and Starcoder, which is a 15 billion parameter model. And they're comparing it with a baseline, which is no debugger, but also with another paper that has a technique called self-debugging. A note to self, I need to check out that paper. And as you can see, with this kind of debugging with execution traces, they get a nearly 10% bump on various coding benchmarks. And the metric they're looking at is pass at one. So passing on the first try. The other interesting thing to note is that if you look at all the problems in the benchmark set and classify them into easy, medium, and hard, the biggest gains compared to other methods that you see with this method are in the hard problems. So they have a negligible gain in the easy ones, a small gain in the medium ones, but a pretty noticeable jump compared to the other methods on the hard problems. So that shows the efficacy of this technique. All right, so prompts are the new source code, so we gotta look at the prompts. Thankfully, the authors did provide prompts in the appendix. So let's walk through one example loop of this methodology. You have a system prompt, pretty simple. You are an expert programming assistant, and you kick off with your task description. Given a list of numbers, return whether they are sorted. Return false if the list has more than one duplicate of the same number. All right, and then you give a number of test cases to check against. Here you see the very first reply from the LLM, and then you run your tests and see that it fails one of them. And here's the prompt that you construct. So you give it the failed test case, and this chunk is the prompt, which is telling the LLM that you're giving it a block by block execution trace, and you're asking the LLM for each block if that block, the code in that block, is correct or not. And if not, give an explanation for what is wrong. And this is actually a few short prompt. They give a couple of examples here. And then that is followed by a textual encoding of the block by block values of the various variables in this execution trace. So the LLM takes that long prompt, and this is the result it comes back with. So for some blocks, it says that yes, that block seems to be correct. And here in this case, there was a bug in block number 5, and it says false for correctness and provides an explanation. The block is incorrect because greater than 1 should actually have been greater than 2. The user follows that up with a prompt saying, please fix the code. And the LLM comes back with a fixed version of the code. And you can see how it has changed this greater than condition over here. And that passes all the unit tests. So you can see how this is mimicking the typical human process of debugging code. I hope you enjoyed that. If you like content like this, please consider subscribing, like the video, leave a comment, and I will see you all next time. Thank you very much.